Thank you, everyone, for coming to the seminar, and thanks a lot for waiting for this trouble all around. So today, it's our pleasure to have Marcin, our colleague. So we all know Marcin very well, but still, let me just briefly introduce him. So he did his PhD in COMPASS in 2006, and then he went for Freiburg University in Germany for a fellow, and then at CERN also for a fellow for 3 years. And he has been with us since 2010. So he did his PhD in COMPASS, but also started working in Atlas and more recently in Amber. So he's done a lot of work in spin structure, fragmentation functions, and also application of the neural networks to high energy physics. So today he's going to talk about the latest results on COMPASS. So again, thank you very much, Martin, for accepting our invitation. So it's all yours.
Okay, so I will talk about exploring hadronic universe with COMPASS. The idea was that what is inside nucleon, but also there will be a bit about universe of particles. Now it's not working. Oh, yeah, converging still. Okay. And Mark has to be here, yes.
Okay.
So that's for reminders if there might be new student or so where it's COMPASS. This is the BKLH series. COMPASS is related to SPS, exactly. This is the North area, and we are sitting somewhere here. In short, okay, there will be small troubles with this, maybe. For people who are here, because of, well, maybe not. No, yes. I don't remember either.
It was you or it was me?
Yeah, I was not touching.
So
you can click on the green thing, and like when you click, you can move.
Yeah, but this mouse is not really. I don't think it's. Yeah, any place here it's bad. So.
That was me. It's fine.
Okay, so COMPASS is experiment where we have like 12 different countries, about 120 physicists. We have like phase one from 2002 to 2011, and now phase two is ongoing, and the last day taking should be next year. But there is also future, is the other experiment, which was approved last year. And already this year, there were some test data, but I will not talk about it. Just briefly about physics. So in phase one, we were at least also at LEAP mostly interested in muon beam program. We were studying hadron polarization, spin-dependent structure function, polarized plot distribution, and unpolarized fragmentation functions. In phase two, the shift moved to transverse momentum-dependent functions, TMDs, with muon and hadron beams, in fact, and then generalized parton distribution functions, which at least we don't really take part, and then still continuing unpolarized fragmentation functions. I still report a bit about COMPASS, since there is many new people, so that's to remind. So COMPASS is a fixed target detector. So the target is somewhere here, the beam comes from this side. This is around 60 meter length. You have two magnets, which here are in red. In total, about 350 detector planes, and I think 12 or 13 different types of tracking detectors. So this is a lot, partially because people wanted to test new technology also in view of LAC and so on. But this makes, of course, a bit of difficulty. The beam we have. One of the features of COMPASS is that we can have both muon beams, pion beams, so both muon, pion, hadron, can have also proton beam. muon beam is polarized, we can reach around 60% polarization. However, in all results which I will show today, the polarization is not used, so I'm not going to talk about it. Usually we use pi minus beam at higher energy. However, we will also have polarized targets, and there will be many results related with polarized targets, mostly with NH3 target, which had four cells in total 1.2 meters length, and we could reach polarization 80-90%. In part of the year, years, we have also liquid hydrogen targets, much longer, 2.5 meters, but of course, like hydrogen is very light. So might be longer to get some statistical, so aluminium and tungsten factors. A compact structure, weak acceptor from 108 microns, able to reconstruct track from hard VD. We can use identified hadrons, electron muons using ECAL, HCAL, and muon filters. And also because we have this detector, we are able to identify ion tails and protons starting from this threshold, which could be free impact. Now, shortly about beam. So, what happens is the beam is accelerated in SPSS S to around 450 dB. These are protons. And then they hit beryllium targets, P6. And then secondary particles are produced mostly by ion tails. And if you want to use ion beam or proton beam or so, we simply can take that. So we never can in compact get this primary proton beam. It's impossible. We always have to use secondary. Or if you want to wait, ions and kions are not stable, they decay into muons. And this is like decay channel. Then we can put absorber which stops our hadrons, and then in compact we can crack muon beam. The switch from hadron to muon beam takes around half an hour. So this is very fast. So the muon beam intensity, we have like 4 to the 10 to the 7 per seconds. And efficiency is conversion is quite low. For one incoming proton, for 10 to the 5 of incoming proton, we can get only one muon. Now about a bit polarization of the target, since I said the beam is polarized, but we will not use it for this physics now, but the target is. So if you think about atom in the strong magnetic field at low temperature, the energy levels separate themselves. And formally, you can achieve spontaneous polarization of the path. If you would pull down the target as we do it to 50 millikelvins, and you have magnetic fields like 2.5 Tesla, the electrons are almost fully polarized. You can reach almost 100% polarization of the electrons, but proton polarization is only 1%. So we cannot polarize nucleons using this method, and the reason is that the magnetic moment of the proton is much smaller because of its mass than the magnetic moment of electron. But people were clever, and instead of this method, we will use dynamic nuclear polarization. And the idea is that we want to make simultaneous sleep of both spin of the proton and electron. So basically, from, for example, here, we want to pump everything according to this law. Then what happens, since electron is very light, it's very fast relaxates to the ground state. Why? Now, the fact that the proton is heavy, it does not want. Also, in this case, you don't see the difference of energy, it's not that here are gigahertz and then omega is on mega. So it's big difference orders of magnitude, of course, related with the mass. Also, what is important that you need really very precise frequency to make this happen, and also the magnetic field has to be very uniform, 10 to minus 4 around. This is how more or less the target looks like. This is 1 meter. The target is here, and you have all cooling system that you have to read this 50 millikelvins, and this is the magnet around. Now, the processes which we studied at the beginning. The first is deep and elastic scattering. Basically, you have incoming muon and outgoing muon, and this is the only thing which we can measure. We know that there is a mass, and we don't look at what happens with the drop. We just know that it should be destroyed. And this is the keenest measurement what we can do. However, you cannot do too much with it. You can do much more if, for example, you have the same stuff, but you would see what happens with X. Maybe there is pion, maybe there is gap. And this is called semi-inclusive generalized scatter. So the difference is that we look on the final state, but we don't need to look on all of it. If we would look on all of it, we would call it exclusive. We just select that one particle, two particles with certain moments. So we still, there is a lot of things which we are not. We just know, okay, there is some. So we can do much more physics with it, but there is additional complication that you need to know, for example, probability that the photon starts some pattern, let's say U-quark, and then you want to relate what is probability that U-quark will fragment you and then gives you ion, for example, or care. And for this, you need a new object, which is fragmentation patch. Before we go more to fragmentation facts, I will tell about kinematic edit with variables which we use. So there is Q squared, which is negative four momentum transfer from lepton to neutron. Basically, this is a virtual photon resolution. So something which at low Q squared seems to be quark. When you increase Q squared, you could see that it might be quark, which emitted blue one, with then you can Q bar and then more blue. Yeah. So this is basically scaling. Evaluation. Yeah. The Q equal one corresponds to around one Fermi, this typical assumption. So this is like size of the movement. Yeah. So we have to be around this region to be able to see what is in nuclear. And also because of alpha S behavior, only region Q square above one is the perturbative region where you can make the QCD calculation. So here, then I go to Björkenex. So basically, Björkenex is that when the photon struck the quark on the nucleon, it tells you in this infinite moment plane, what is the fraction of the proton momentum carried by this quark. So it might be from 0 to 1. And here I show you how the typical X and Q square looks like. Note that one is here. So you see that most of the data is in the region where formally you cannot go to the calculation. However, this was needed for phase one, where we were producing charm. And when you produce heavy quarks, there's even if it's very slow, the scale of the interaction was happening. This was for noise. But now most of the what you are interested is about. However, look that yes, we measure things here, but there is a lot of white thing, and this will be useful in two slides. This region here is basically not the problem. Also, one can define other variables which are correlated with exclusive term, like photon energy or fraction of photon energy with respect to the beam. Yeah, so, if y is equal to 0.9, it means that the virtual photon carries 90% of the energy. Finally, the most important series variable is z, which tells you what fraction of the gamma star energy was taken by the quark. Yeah? Because the quark absorbs all energy of the incoming photon, but then when you have this fragmentation, you can produce many hadrons. And then you want to know that the hadrons which you look at how much energy of the given photon has. Now we go to the fragmentation functions. So as I was mentioning, just to remind, the idea is that they are needed when we deal with the hadron in the final state. And my idea is that if you imagine K plus, which is U and
is it okay? Yeah.
This is probability to originate from the big one, then pi minus, yeah, because imagine that deep one is balanced part of the pi minus, so it's easy to create, while there is no big one in A plus. So this means it's much harder to create, yeah, from the big one. But if it would be U quark, it's easier to create U because it's balanced than pi minus, because you need to go to negative start and to start with plus two pi. Yeah. So in leading order, in fact, fragmentation function, which we call D2H, describes probability density that you have the flavor Q fragment into the hadron of type A, assuming next to the infinitesimal part. We also often say about favored and unfavored fragmentation function, depending if this quark is a valence quark of A. And so, for example, for D quark, fragmentation to pi minus is favored, while fragmentation to a plateau would probably sometimes. Now, how you measure fragmentation function, you do it by hadron multiplicities. So it's the number of offset hadrons divided by number of the Earth events. And you can write it in the order is very simple formula like this, where you have the, these are PDFs and these are your fragmentation function. So basically, you assume PDFs are null. You can move everything on the other side and then get info about fragmentation. Of course, we have some complexity, so it's complex. So, of course, when you measure this multiplicity, you get prepared by various effects like spectrometer acceptance, construction efficiency. Then you have rich efficiency purity when you deal with ion pumps and protons, and also radiative correction. Here is just an example of how such multiplicity looks like. So you see different values of x. So the x is increasing, this means this quark is carrying more, well, you can imagine mass or fraction of this momentum of the proton. And here is the z. As you see, as the z increases, usually this fragmentation goes down. So this means it's very difficult that the one single hadron takes almost all amounts of energy of the incant of the stacked one. Yeah? And then if you would integrate over the Z, let's say this distribution, you would get that you would get like 15% of chances that you have carrion in the event, in my case. Now, what is interesting also here is the QM multiplicity sum. Because it's, it gives easy access to S, so it's trap density times fragmentation functions. And this we need when we, for example, want to study polarization of the strange quarks, which we were measuring phase one, but many of these measurements were we cannot fully use still until now because of the problem with knowledge of fragmentation function. And this is one of the reasons which we are still trying to study them. Because without them, we cannot fully use potential of our data, which we already have, or theory groups can. So here, when you make all the calculations, it turns out that there is simple relation that time times multiplicity sum you measure is equal to the integral over the z of the this fragmentation function, which has this of partons, and then this is what we are interested in. So the idea is that if you are at high x over here, you have almost clean access to DQ, okay? Because at very high x, there is no strange quark, they only come from gluons in the C. And then you expect when you go to lower x, you should have this influence, yeah? But you see that it's not much. You see maybe some effect, but the thing that it goes down, it's also related to the fact that here basically you have two square equal one, so you don't have so many S plus. While here you have higher two square and it turns out that you should have like 40% more S plus than in this point. So this, in fact, we are happy to see this behavior. So this we would like to see. But you see, for example, that for many years, the problem that the Hermes experiment measured totally different bands. And as you see, like, here, basically, you should never have the fragmentation pattern. There is nothing else. This should be exactly the same, except they are smaller energy, but formally, the difference should not be there. So there might be something ongoing, or that somebody make measurement wrong. And the idea is that now we have, previously, for many years, we have only isoscalar target, which is in red. Now we measure also on the proton target, it's the same in the result. You see that the agreement is very similar. It should not be the same, of course, because we have different quantum contributing. So this formula is only for hyperscalar targets, so you cannot. But you see that this difference is similar. And this partially, I think we kind of understand it. So I will go with it. But we found also that when you go to multiplicity ratio, the plus of it that there's a lot of things which cancel that, like both experimental part and the theoretical uncertainty. So it's nice observable. I just try to, in leading order, how the ratio for chaos and proton looks like. The interesting part is that in leading order, the things are really simple. You can write them down even as experimentalists without something. So, and then when you know that this DM framework is expected to be smaller than Z, you can neglect it. You make simplification. And if you know that this S times fragmentation function, which is probability also must be positive, if you want to go to lower limit, you can also neglect. You suddenly get that your ratio of chaos to proton is equal to just the ratio of PDFs. And by the way, it's the same PDFs for proton, chaos, and proton. This is also for the return time. So this is, of course, the lower limit predicted by leading order PQCD and are the same. Yeah? In reality, you would expect to have result above, yeah? Because first, in chaos, you have this S, this strength, which is in fact favorable representation. And you have small parts of the unfavorable, there might be smaller than that. Yeah? So we like to see it close to the limits. Yeah? And then you can ask why I don't talk about pions, because they are more abundant. Of course, you have four or five times more pions than chaos. It turned out that at very high Z, which we will be soon interested, they suffer from large contamination of decay product on diffractive flow. And why this is better will show the plan. But we simply give up analyzing this, although then there is no effect, in fact, which I will go now. So that these are the results of multiplicity of chaos. We already published two papers on it. In the first paper, we were able to reach this level, the red points, and then we managed to extend the range. This is of course limited by the rich identification. It's current of the vector, so it has some range to identify. And basically what you see is as a function of new in different Z beams. But if you go to, let's say, quite high Z, this is the limit. And everything should be above. Yeah, this is the leading order limit. So the simple calculation, what I was showing. Then if you go to, like, play with next to leading order, make all the math, you will get this step and these are the ends. And you see that basically all the results which we got, they are far below this curve, while we could be up. Yeah? And then even when we extend it, we see the trend that clearly when increasing mu, we are getting closer to the limit. So at some point, the limit will be probably reached and maybe even go above, like yeah, you are above the limit. So this is definitely not expected and not taken into account. The thing is that there is many interesting physics which happen like around this region, which has the effects of this physics. Like TMDs will be taken later at the highest. And then you want to use PQCD. Yeah? But then your problem is that you have problem that the PQCD doesn't describe the data. So there is some work. Yeah? Now you see that there is many curves here, and we found out that okay, when you produce phased curves, of course you reduce the phase space for other interactions. Yeah? Other particles to be produced. And still, you need to fulfill conservation law, yeah, Strandberg, baryon number, and so on. So this means the fact that it's really limited, plus for sure you must have proton somewhere or neutron or so on and so on. So what we did, instead of this, we make thinking about missing mass, which basically this is how much energy or mass was left to produce some more time. Yeah? And you see that all this data goes on a quite smooth path. Yeah, the open points are the first publication and the second publication, which follow with extended record. You see that it seems this variable, there is some immediate meaning there that is very nice. Now, about the, why we were able to do this extended range of identification in the reach. In fact, it was how in LEAP we were doing it. So, ordinarily, what we use was likelihood. So, formally, likelihood should be the best and so on. And this is likelihood of L divided by likelihood of pi. This is rather high momentum. This was the top, what we could achieve before, basically. And you see that you don't see where chaos are, you believe that it should be somewhere in the tail, of course, but you don't have any peaks anything. Yeah. So we were cutting around here, and of course, make systematic stuff and so on. And then our idea was that, okay, the reach is complex, you have mirrors, complex system. So what we did put information about tracks to the neural networks, like angle, momentum, and so on, and then see if neural network is able to find some like internal inconsistency in the description or so. And this is basically one of the variables you see such a nice picture. When you see that the certain points are above, the angle of the emission of the photon is different than in the optics. Yeah. So what you want to do, of course, this should be flat. So we then use the neural network to correct. And this is the correction. And what you get are there that for the same data, you get such picture, and now you clearly see that there is scale and there is a fact. However, if you would really check carefully, you would see that the correction level is not so big. This means that even if without this correction, there would be a peak here, somewhere here, smaller, but it would be. And this is the warning for the young students, which when you work with likelihood, now everybody says it's the best whatever, but if there is problem and your description is not perfect, you will bias likelihood much more. And then there might be other methods which are more stable or more robust for the trap. Like for example, in this case, this was the angle of the emission. When the likelihood, you put angle of the emission of every photon and very complex things. And since this was kind of not working perfectly, the bias was so large here that it was basically destroying the peak, which ordinarily something you could see on this picture here. So this is the warning to be very careful with likelihood. Yeah? It's really the best if you really know what you are doing. Yeah? Now, these are the results for the protons. And proton is heavier, so we were expecting even more trouble, and indeed, this is the ratio of T1 over T. Here you can have only lower limit because there is no fragmentation function really for the proton, so we could not calculate where the analog limit is. Probably should be below it. But you see that everywhere the results are indeed below the curve. So, and you see that while in Keon case, we start measuring 0.7 and then you still was agreement for higher mu with the leading for the limit or so, you see that even at 0.5 Z, so much lower Z, you are already below the limit. So you definitely do not produce enough antiproton versus proton as QCD predicted. Finally, the last slide. You may remember yeah, that LPR and K limits, lower limits are the same in dealing with the QCD. In reality, we would expect only 10% difference between them because of the strange fragmentation in this paper. But if you look on the result as a function of that, you see that the difference is like 50% or so. It's also much bigger. And you see it everywhere. Okay, now we change a bit. So we assume that we have this fragmentation function and so on. Then we can use in studying this nucleon various functions. So these are like here you have nucleon, which is unpolarized longitudinally polarized transverse polarized. And the same for the quad polarization inside of this nucleon. So you see you have H function. And most of you is only using this one. So you have unpolarized LHC data, for example, and so. In phase one in compass, we are also studying quite this because we have polarized beam and agriculture. Why not we are studying all eight? What is important that all of them depend upon KT of the quark, so existing transverse moment of the quark. And when you integrate over it, basically only this, this, and this survives. All others will back up. So, and basically, yeah, this how one can describe 3D structure of the nucleon, so you need eight functions. For example, not that easy, like you have one PDF or so, you have eight different functions which you need. This is the cross section formula. It's a bit complex. You see the X, the Y, the Z. This is not X, Y, Z of the space, but this is this geochemate, Y of the photon and Z of the hadron. You see, you need to have also PT of the hadron, angle of the hadron, and two angles of the hadrons. It's basically the idea that you have electron scattering flame, so you emit photon, and then you hadron is emitted at some angle, and also the beam, the target was polarized at some angle. So basically, if you look on the formula, you have various combinations of this angle, yeah, like the difference, the sum, 3 times 1, minus, and so on. So the idea is that all of them in fact are of course orthogonal to each other, so that's why you can study it more or less kind of easily. It's a lot of them, and if I would be an expert and it would be only talk about TMDs, I should select one of them and talk about it for probably 20, 40 minutes. But I will not do it. But I guess there is a lot of them. We can study them. And main reason is because luckily different modulation are responsible for different species. However, before going to the results, I will tell you why there will be not too many new results about this subject. And there will be two problems. One is diffractively produced vector matrix. So basically, what we were doing so far it was CDs or DIS where the target nucleon was destroyed. Yeah? We photon was hitting the proton, the struck quark was expected, removed, and the proton was then destroyed and infected. In this case, what happens when you have diffractive production, the virtual photons became vector meson. Because it has the same quantum number. So basically, you set photon, it goes to QQ bar. It takes some energy from the proton and it can form, for example, rho meson or phi meson. But this is not part of DIS because then the proton stays intact. In compass, low XO2 square, it accounts 5-8% of the cross section. So you can say, okay, it's not that much. But unfortunately, when you go to high Z, when a lot of interesting things happen, then, for example, in pion case, you can have 30 or 40% pion originated from the decay of diffractively produced pion. And this is at Z equal 0.8. When we would go to that almost equal one, it's like 90-95%. That's why this ratio was not studied. But even worse, what was realized not so long ago, that this event has very large azimuthal asymmetries. Which you basically see here. This is the angle of the hadron, this is that. So before, some of people were naive and they thought this was flat. While in reality, you can have like here 50%, here even more asymmetric. Because basically, if you imagine slice in Z, in one dimension, you have to fit it by the harmonics. And then your physics has some harmonics, and then you check what harmonics are here and what bias you can have. And then the problem was that, okay, so since we have like 30 or 40 events with 50% symmetry, this gives you like bias of 0.15. And in reality, the CDS effects are expected to be order of smaller. And basically, if you look on here, this is the high Z beam. This is what we publish ordinarily. It has relatively small errors, and it was very big, like asymmetric minus 0.3. And the problem was that the repetition said that then there is no way they can describe it. And then people are starting looking at and so on, and okay, we figured out that it might be done with this. And then indeed the results move up. Errors exist a lot because at the time when we managed to make these publications, we still did not have optimized method to estimate how many vector mesons are there. So if you put the uncertainty of how many vector mesons is there, was, you know, but this was one of the problems, which now is more under control. What is interesting that in multiplicity analysis, which I was showing before, we knew that they are there and we were removing them. But here the colleagues were more, let's say, reluctant and so on. Because you may laugh, but it's not so simple. The problem is in reality that when you have like HERA or so, or you have collider, you are not able to say that the proton is intact because everything goes to the fire. So what they did, and it's in every PDF since then, that this event, in fact, is diffractive production is included in your PDFs. It could be, for example, one of the reasons why when you took all this data earlier one and they tried to extrapolate to LHC, the cross-section were not matching so well. Right? Because like ordinal scenes, one of them comes from the fact that you do put some contribution, which is incorrect and return percent, which is not CDs or DIS, you put it to the cross section, and then your feed has to tell you if it was U quark, D quark, or S quark, whatever you want. But this process has nothing to do. So even now there are still discussion how we should proceed further, yeah? Because then we have these PDFs which are wrong DB part. So what we usually do, we publish as methods without correction. And then we put what correction according to us would be there. But one should keep in mind this. The second problem is the radiative corrections. So it's fine, you have this like muon here, but from time to time it can produce the real form. That happens, yeah. Formally, you should say, okay, alpha electromagnetic is like 1 over 137, more or less. We are still at very low energy. So at Z, is, Z mass would be like 128, here we still 28. So it should be small, right? But it's not so much. There are two problems here. You have tail of elastic, some elastic. So elastic scattering mu p, you can produce gamma. And this cross section is very big. It can be 1 million times bigger than the AS or so. Yeah. And if you are unlucky, this may contribute to your cross section. The other problem is that when you have given X, Björken, and Q squared, so imagine in the 2D some point, turns out that all events from X, Björken, larger than what you can see can contribute there. And all Q squared. So can be if you go to lower cluster, you have bigger, larger, and larger region which you can contribute to the radiative correction. Moreover, all cluster is problematic because that is one to the full relative, so you cannot make any calculation, you can just build models. And since it's less interesting, basically you don't have so many measurements down there, yeah. So part of it is unknown, yeah? But okay, still, we have 100 over 137. So is it really important? As you can imagine, if it would not be important, I would not be talking about it. So this is almost extreme compass test in the sense that it's relatively low X and very high Y. And the best our estimate is that the correction is factor 1.7 for BIS. Or this will be different. So basically, this is really that you need to divide yourself total cross section by this factor to get one gamma cross section. Yeah? So this 1 over 137 suddenly gives you 70%. But not that. Then you want to check on Monte Carlo something, how these things react. And unfortunately, when you get like say default Monte Carlo instead of 1.7, you get 2.5, you can get 1.9, 1.63. So it's not all over the place, but very big range. And the problem is that because of this log Q squared data treatment, we have only one parameter to work with. We cannot really get things as nice as we could. But you could say, okay, so still you have some good estimate, you have this some models or so, you don't need Monte Carlo there. But why you need Monte Carlo? The real problem what we have with this CDIS is that The calculation outside of Monte Carlo you can go only basically for GIS case. When you have produced hadrons, you really need to do Monte Carlo to see if there will be neural acceptance, what happens, and so on. So we really need this. And we are still working on it after 10 years because the things are not so simple as. And because these are physics of 60s, yeah, basically you have the cross-section formula and so on. But unfortunately, it turned out that you have this input like Q squared, whatever, which we don't have. We just know, for example, some things that we know, not for example, the real photon interacts with the matter. So we have borders for Q squared equal zero. And then you try to build some models with March and so on, and then I come there. What is worse is that if you have multiplicity, imagine that you remove 20% of hadron, but 20% of hadron comes from this higher edge, net effect is zero. So you don't correct by anything you have. But if you study azimuthal asymmetries, 20% of hadron go away, 20% of hadron comes. But unfortunately, for this 20% of hadrons, you have known wrong kinematics, which means your angles are wrong and your azimuthal asymmetries are wrong, so you have big bias. By the way, if you think about future EIC, or even this big, which is standard set, then the problem will be bigger even. Like in EIC, it will be like factor 2-3 bigger because of lower X and also electron beam is used instead of ground. But at least they are aware of it and they also try to work on it as far as I know, even if there is more than 10 years to go. Okay, I will check the time. Okay, we're very late. It was not fully my fault. The Sievers effect. So just to remind, this is a polarized quantum transversely polarized target. The modulation is on SIDIS. It's one of the most interesting observables because it's related to angular momentum of pulsar gluon in the proton. So basically, this was in phase one that we were attacking. We're interested mostly in delta G. You know, the spin of the protons should be 1/2. Originally, we thought of the models were showing the delta sigma should carry all the spin of the proton. Yeah, because you have UUD quarks, so you can easily make 1/2. The measurements show that it's not the case. Delta G turned out to be small and not enough. And 20 years ago, there was no idea how to access this L2LG. And we know that there is some relation, unfortunately, we don't know it numerically, how it is, between the Sievers effect and LQ or LG. But at least we see that the Sievers effect does exist. So it's one of this modulation is definitely non zero. Well, we know that Sievers effect exists. This means also there must be the angular momentum in this case of quark. We also make some measurements for the gluon. However, the interesting thing is that usually people think that all right, PDFs are universal, which means you have, for example, EP collision. And then you use the same PDFs for PP. And that's why we can use Faraday and other, and then the cross section for array theta. Turns out that Sievers is not universal function. In particular, for example, for Drell-Yan process, the Sievers function expect to change sign. The Drell-Yan process is shown here, basically you can find the relation of the proton to hadrons, of the quarks and antiquarks from the two hadrons, and they form the photon, not gluon, but photon. And then photon goes, you see virtual photon, it goes to the real pair of neck. So this is Drell-Yan process. The sign of change is related with impact of final versus initial interaction. So if you have photon at the beginning, does not interact strongly, so nothing can kill. When you struck quark, then this can interact with the red magnet, and it turns out that you bend the sign in one direction. If you have Drell-Yan process, it's opposite. Yeah? The quark is incoming. And then that is repulsive. Later, you produce virtual gamma, which do not interact. That's one. Net effect would be zero. But here it goes in one direction, here in the other. Basically, we studied this in compass. So it's pi minus proton goes to V plus V minus. plus something. We don't care what it is, we don't measure it. In fact, we search for the muons having large invariant mass, because then you have really clean source of the Drell-Yan. But you have relatively very low cross section, like 10 to minus 6 of total finite. So you need very high intensity beam. But if you would put it in compass, you would kill all the detectors. This means you have to put a hadron absorber. However, when you put hadron absorber, you have force resolution of the invariant mass, and also you will kill all intensity mass. Yeah. So you lose like factor 2. So this is the mass spectrum, how it looks like. We have, in fact, these two targets are polarized, and this is used for the Sievers measurement, but we have also like an aluminium target and the tungsten target. And this is the beam plug, in fact, which is supposed to stop the beam that does not reach the chromium. But we can also use them. This is X, like kind of Bjorken X, but for pion and neutron, from where these two quarks come from. And you see that for pion, we are in the definitely valence region. But for nucleon, it's okay from 0.05 to 0.27, also close to vast, definitely not big C. And this is the result that I first published in 2017. So this is different models with the sign change. This is without sign change, of course. Well, of course, not of course, but the errors were still large that you can say that you prefer this solution, but you definitely can exclude these ones. These are the new results containing part of 2018 data. So if you have X5, this is this picture. You see, unfortunately, they went closer to zero. But I think if you make average, the average did not change, but the error will shrink. So the statement is still the same. We prefer such a scenario, but we cannot exclude that. Also, like in the case of CIDIS, you also have different modulation of possible modulation of the cross section. So you can study like here, four of them. All of them are almost zero. So that's why I will, okay, we measure them, but we don't see the effect. You could see that here, the effect is around 3 sigma. Okay, but you have to take into account that you have 20 pops and 3 points in each of them, it's in 60 plus. So you have to then multiply 3 sigma, effect is 0.997 to the power of 60. You will have 20% of probability to see such effect on this kind of plot. Well, this is a statistical calculation. Yeah? So that's why we don't really get excited about 3 sigma. We think it's okay. There was 20% chance to have something like this. Maybe we have. Yeah. But of course, in future, if we error string down and we get 4 or 5 sigma, situation will be slightly different. These are the polarized asymmetries. We also can measure unpolarized asymmetries. And this is the cross section formula where you have theta angle is the so called in software frame. I will not explain, but more or less you can imagine that in one plane you have annihilation of the quark and the photon is emitted, and then the electron can have some angle with respect to this plane, and then there is some polarization of the target. Yeah. And basically, lambda should be 1 if it would be only electromagnetic annihilation. If you have include QCD correction, you have in fact this relation. But if you measure it, so this would be this relation, you see that it's violated. Yeah, before you have experiments like NATEN, which was much more precise because they were underground. But there was some other one which results were not consistent and compact results prefer NATEN. Then we go fast to GPDs. GPDs are interesting because there is also this unbroken proton spin. This time you don't have this delta spin and so on, but you have total angular momentum of quarks and gluon. The difference is that there is clear theoretical relation between total angular momentum of quarks and GPDs. Contrary to TMDs, where we know that this exists, but we don't know how it looks like. So that's why the GPDs and some interest. Yeah? Contrary to ordinary PDF, there are complex numbers, there are again 8 of them. partonic, you go to that round and you want. And then you have different processes which are sensitive to different parts. The golden tunnel is the DVCS, which is proton with mass close to proton, muon, and gamma. So note that you need to measure full final state, including this low energy proton. Main background is this is like Wettenheimer process. So it's very part of radiative correction, yeah. And since the final state is the same, you have also interference. These are the results. Basically, when you are at very high mu, you have suddenly have better higher process, and this is you have this the angle pi, you have Dayton Monte Carlo. When you go to lower mu, you should still have more and more DVCS, which main part would be flex. And basically, you see that this is your expected Monte Carlo. While you have much more events, and these are the DVCS events we are searching. Later, when you have more data, because this is still part of the data, we can also try to measure other GPDs related to fragmentation. But if we stay only with this one, C0, so you can do some interesting physics, because this one is related with the transverse size of the proton. The idea is that if you have valence quarks of high X, they are very concentrated in the cold, let's say. When you go to X higher, like pi of cloud, you have them more far away, and the C is around on the top. So basically, what you do, this is 2012 data, but they were published very recently. Newer data should be available for public. So basically, what we're asking to do, measure the slope of the cross section of a function of T. So how much for momentum is transferred to the virtual proton, to the proton of the virtual. When you have the B, you make some calculation and then you track that this is the radius of the this transverse size of the proton, which you see is around 0.858 fermi. So here you have different experiments. This is our experiment. The new one will be slightly higher. But what's interesting to see is that this 0.58, if you compare 0.84 of the standard size, yeah, so you see that maybe indeed there is something that this is more extreme than the proton, which we know is like 0.84 tech, yeah. It is errors, even compass frozen errors, yeah, it may be deep. We also measure other things, like not only DVCS, but like this production of the mesons. So for example, this is for exclusive pi zero production. You can study them here a lot in DVDs. The problem is that DVCS is much well known traditionally. There is much more problems here. So you see you have some model here, second model upgraded here, but our data do not follow. And then we can have other, of course, you have from Amazon Omega, you have also data there, but this is more theoretical challenge. Yeah, so while we produce new data also that people need to move forward with the field. And then I will go to last part, hadron spectroscopy. So this we are not really doing currently, but also in the past. So there, the same funny thing, yeah? This is the Atlas result from us. So this is the Higgs, as it was in 2012 from four lepton case. So you saw this very small peak, and of course, when you added different channels, then you could find that there was five sigma sigma. But still, there was a small peak, and everybody is 100% sure that the Higgs is there, yeah, there's no doubt. The thing is, the life is not so easy, and now I will tell you a short story about A1-1400. What happens is you study interaction of proton with pion. It goes via polarized, so you can imagine as you do, for example. And you will have some resonance X, which will decay in 3 pions at the very end. And the idea is that you can formalize certain new physics here, yeah, like in LHC. Yeah? You have some intermediate particle, which can be something interesting. Yeah? So all ordinary states, like we have measure or baryons, you have only certain quantum number allowed. And then you can think, okay, if there are some particles with different quantum numbers, like that quarks or things like this, you could have them also exchange here. So the goal is that I can also contribute to three-pointed masses, like you want to know mass, width, and quantum numbers. The problem starts when you have interference of algebra, yeah? So it's coherent somehow, but not like in case of Higgs, where, okay, the Higgs is there, it should be one on some background. Here you have many, how many? For example, you set of 88 waves, which many of them can interfere with each other. The wave you can describe by the sum like J, so that momentum, parity, JPC, and so on. What F0 is related to this, then there is additional time, and what is angular momentum between this. Now, this is just the name of the wave, then you would have like formula for the fault time, how the wave is really good. You do the analysis. This, the black, is your spectrum, and you have get some waves from this procedure. All of them are orthogonal, so the error is funny. And there is some only 0.3% intensity in some this wave was found. Yeah. So one of the 0.3 may not be impressive if you got on the errors. Errors are small because you have like 20,000 events, and if the things are orthogonal, it doesn't matter that it's only 0.3%. Yeah. It's whatever. When you do this physics, in fact, if you will show only big nobody cares, yeah, that if you can generate if you wish. What is important is the phase motion between some known resonance, like wrong for example, partially. Only that you principle can say that yes, there is that. Yeah. It's like mechanics, yeah. When you would imagine, I don't know, not your or some string. And with some weight at the end, yeah, there is some resonance frequency. If you go below resonance frequency to above resonance frequency, you can face more from this time. And exactly the same is with the arms. So basically, you have very nice peak, very nice phase motion, is it perfect one? There were a few working lights, like was rather close to the ground state, 226. And that smaller width, which is a bit weird that something which is excited is a smaller width than the target. And also was close to a star example. What colleagues in Compass did, they recognized that in theory, you could have such kind of diagram also, that the parent would be A1 1260, some resonance, well known. It could go to K star, and you can produce final space requirements this way. If they calculated amplitudes, yes, you have a very nice peak. And then if you put them together, it turns out that this peak also very well describes the data. Here you have only 3,000 events because it was checking different T ranges again. And this is the Raman plot to see how the resonance goes. So at zero, you should have the mass of the resonance and so on. So of course, then you have like Occam razor, so you can't say that the resonance does not exist, but also it's not really needed. For us, that's not really exist. So this is, you see, the life, beautiful peak. I thought this shows that this whole study of like network traffic exotic would be much more complex because you have to also take into account these things. And you have meson table many pages in PDG, so to find all the combination, not easy. Okay, this is the one slide. This was also some exotic quantum numbers, which would be like U bar D and gluon inside in the valence region. Originally, it was seen by VNL in 1998, I think, not confirmed by BEST. Funny, we confirmed both observations, so we agree with both experiments, namely, at low T, we did do not see it, as it was not seen by BEST. This is this thing. This, okay, it's more than here, but it's nothing serious. But when you go to high T, we indeed need this resonance to describe the thing by last spectrum, which by the way was in the range of BNR. Yeah. So this is also, so it seems that this exotic may indeed exist. So the summary, finally, Liliana is very unhappy, sorry. Okay, I will not say that. For your recent results, there were some interesting ones, I hope. We still have 1 year to go, and we have to still finish analysis, because of the problem. But that information that provides on hand, it will come up. Thank you.
Well, thanks a lot.